a sorry sinner, so pay attention to what you shouldn't be doing. Get that thing out of my face a little bit. I'm not sure anybody wants to hear this lesson today anyhow.
Well, I know I do. I'm going to be listening downstairs.
Yeah. Hey, Ted Wood, that was sort of sadistic. Yeah. 2 minutes. 2 minutes and counting. Travis, you going to count me down? Okay, first off, let's start with prayer. Sure am going to need it today with this lesson. Dear Lord, we come to you this Sabbath day thanking you for your holy word. Thanking you, Father, that you know best. So many times we don't understand, but we have faith and confidence that you know best. So, Father, I pray that this lesson, that you would receive honor and glory. Guide me, Father, as I read what has been copied. In Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen. Okay, as many of you, I hope, knows, we're in the book of Song of Songs. And the title of our lesson today is Relational Foundations. If you are so inclined, I would like for you to turn to the Song of Songs chapter 2, and we're going to start with verse 15. I want you to pay particular attention, not so much, I don't know how to say this, I'm going to say not so much for what is we could mistake the lesson today for a secular lesson, but I want you to know, as it says here in this very first sentence, God created humans to be relational, with the greatest relationship being between him and his people. So let's look at a couple things about this book before we get started in the scripture. First, the author, of course, is Solomon. This unique book is a moving love story about a young country girl and King Solomon. In delicate poetry, the lovers express intense passion and deep longing for each other. The young girl compares her love for her husband to the anticipation of a frantic search, while Solomon likens his bride's beauty to a picturesque gardens and delicious fruit. Yet even in this eloquent expression of the passions between the bride and the bridegroom, there is an exhortation to remain sexually pure before marriage. In this way, the book celebrates human sexuality within the context of marriage. I'd like to add to that, but I won't. So you can thank yourself for that. This book has not always been understood in this way. Jewish scholars around the time of the birth of Christ interpreted the book allegorically, stating that it describes the love of God for Israel. Similarly, some Christians have taught that the book speaks of the mystical relationship of the Lord Jesus Christ and his bride, the church. That's what I want you to remember. Let's for a moment consider the different options held on this book without entering into the discussion of their propriety or impropriety. They are as following. Now, in order to give us a better understanding, I went to the Matthew Henry commentary, which is a very good commentary. If y'all don't have it, I'd recommend it. First, it is a plain poem on the marriage of Solomon with the daughter of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and is to be understood in no other way. It is an allegory relative to the conduct of God towards the Hebrews in bringing them out of Egypt through the wilderness to the promised land. It is intended to represent the incarnation of Jesus Christ or his marriage with the human nature in reference to its redemption. Four, it represents Christ's love to the church or elected souls and their love to him. Five, it is an allegorical poem on the glories of Jesus Christ and the Virgin Mary. It is a collection of sacred idols, the spiritual meaning of which is not agreed on. Now, each of these opinions has its powerful supporters, and each of these has reason to offer for the support of the opinion which is espoused, and nothing but a direct revelation from God can show us which of these opinions is the correct one, or whether any of them are correct. The Song of Solomon retells the romance between King Solomon, the richest king ever to rule Israel, and his beloved bride, who came from a village in the region of Galilee. Solomon owned vineyards all over the nation. One was close to Baal Hamon in the northernmost part of Galilee near the foothills of the mountains of Lebanon. On one of his visits to his vineyard, Solomon met a young woman. Strangely, we never learn her name. She is simply called the Shulamite. After many visits, Solomon proposed. She gave much thought to whether she was ready. She really loved Solomon and could be happy in the palace of a king. Finally, she accepted. If the Bible is a book about God, then one may well ask what a narrative about human sexuality has to do with theology. This is an even more pertinent question when one observes that God is never mentioned in the entire text, except possibly chapter 8, verse 6. Nor are there any references to prayer, worship, or piety. The Song of Solomon provides an example of how God created male and female to live in the happiest and fulfillment. In happiness and fulfillment. Ironically, because of its explicit language, ancient and modern Jewish sages forbade men to read the book before they were 30, and presumably kept women from reading it at all. The Song of Solomon is necessary reading not only for the married, but for young people who want to understand God's design for marriage. The Song of Solomon is a well-crafted yet intriguing poem that celebrates romantic love between a couple on their wedding day. Because of its intriguing subject and intimate language, the song has prompted a variety of interpretations throughout the century. The simply and most straightforward interpretation takes the work of what is purports to be a majestic love story. Having said that, the Song of Songs can still have meaningful application as a dramatic testimony of God's love for the people of Israel and, indeed, Jesus Christ's perfect love for his spiritual bride, the church. Chapter 1 goes on through chapter 2, introduces the couple in love. Chapter 2, the groom invites the woman to enjoy a beautiful spring day with him. On the night before the wedding, the young woman is isolated from her betrothed. In the darkness, she dreams of him. Solomon wrote of the bride calling for the catching of foxes to keep from ruining the vineyard. He was reminding listeners to the need for putting up safeguards to protect relationships. So let's now explore the text. That we're going to go to chapter 2 and start with verse 15. Catch the foxes, the little foxes, before they ruin our vineyards in bloom. The red fox is one of several types of foxes that were common in ancient Israel. A mature fox stood about 16 inches high at the shoulder and weighed about 20 pounds. These animals had relatively short legs and long bushy tails. The climate in Israel was ideal for cultivating grapes. Occasionally, a vine might climb up a limb. The use of handmade trellises had not been introduced in Israel in Solomon's time. Most vines, however, ran along the ground. Consequently, the ease of snatching the ripe fruit made the vineyard a great enticement to the hungry fox. I never thought about that the grapes didn't grow up on trellises, they just let them grow on the ground. The song's intention in verse 15, therefore, is to warn the groom and the bride about overlooking potential problems in their relationship. And that's where you, to me, that goes back to where it's talking about the little foxes, that you've got to catch them. So you got to nip these little things in the bud. They must not allow small but destructive issues to go unaddressed. Small problems left unchecked can hide, fester, and reappear later as larger problems. These problems can then grow into major difficulties that destroy a relationship. In a similar way, believers today are to be careful to protect marriages. Every individual is unique. Therefore, spouses do not always respond in the same way to new situations. Sometimes the difference seems inconsequential. Nevertheless, these differing perspectives can generate conflict. How well we know. If small issues are not tackled and worked through, they grow and merge with other minor concerns. Eventually, they explode and do irreparable damage. Christian couples must erect safeguards to protect their marriage at every stage. Now, in chapter 2, verse 16 and 17, it talks about building trust. Solomon told of the trust needed to sustain a marriage. The husband and wife are to be mutually committed to each other. Verse 16, my lover is mine and I am his. He feeds his flock among the lilies. The words of my love is mine and I am his affirm the mutuality of the couple's love for each other. This declaration has immense importance for comprehending the subsequent lines in the Song of Songs, verses 6 and 17. Both the bride and her groom have chosen an exclusive relationship with each other. Although the pronouns mine and his indicate the bride is speaking at this point, the groom's commitment to his bride must be no less firm. The bride previously describes herself as a lily of the valleys in chapter 2, verse 1. This specific type of flower was not the modern lily, but a variety of wildflowers such as the water lily or lotus flower. In 2:1, the bride uses the analogy to admit that she was of modest beauty. Here in 2:16, her still insecure self-appraisal includes the fact that she is only one of many young maidens the king might have chosen to love and to wed. Indeed, it is possible that the bride still could not believe the king had chosen her for his bride. So she repeated over and over in her mind that it was not a dream. He belonged to her, not to any other of the many young women. Likewise, she belonged to him and to no other man. The phrase, "he feeds among the lilies," stresses the groom's fidelity to his bride. When she first described herself as a lily, he reacted by saying she was like a lily among thorns. In Solomon, chapter 2:2, "like a lily among thorns is my darling among women." So now he enjoys the pleasures that she and she alone gives to him and no other man. This as an essential foundation in any enduring, meaningful relationship, especially the marriage relationships in this verse. The bride expressed her trust in her husband even when he was not in her presence. Trust is not automatic. It is built with commitment and faithfulness. Verse 17, "until the morning breezes blow and the darkness disappears, return, my darling, like a gazelle, like a stag on the mountains of Bether." This verse is filled with intimate imagery. The bride bids her love to turn around from whatever he might be doing and come to her. The phrase, "until the day breaks," suggested that she is inviting him to spend the night with her. Her words expressed her true desires. They likewise expressed his feelings. Repeating words in a marriage ceremony does not necessarily create physical attraction. Physical intimacy between a husband and a wife is a natural component of romantic love. Engaged couples think about their upcoming experiences of intimacy and the preparation for their wedding night. Here is the encouraging invitation which Christ gives to the church and every believing soul to come into communion with him. The romantic love and the sense of fulfillment the bride and groom experienced on their wedding night suggest that the couple honored each other by preserving their purity. Love is better and more fulfilling when we behave the way the Lord instructs us to behave. Mutual submission to God develops and strengthens our trust in each other. Marriages grow through mutual honoring of a husband and a wife to each other. Solomon told the desires of the bride as she longed to be with her husband. In doing so, he included a reminder that one must be careful to avoid sexual temptation of the marriage relationship. Now we're going to go to chapter 3, and it's talking about the bride's dream. Verse 1, "asleep on my bed, night after night, I dreamed of the one I love. I was looking for him and couldn't find him." Chapter 3, 1 through 5 has been interpreted in different ways. A literal interpretation raises numerous difficulties. Roaming in the streets of a city at night would be dangerous for a young woman in any historical era. The lack of any reaction by the city's guards to her presence seems odd. More likely, the verse represents the bride recounting dreams she had on the night before her wedding. The dreams are filled with symbolic meanings concerning the bride's anxiety about giving up her purity and yet longing for physical intimacy with her future husband. As previously noted, her love for the groom was generating strong sexual yearnings within her. This longing for a man she loves was a God-given desire, yet the desire needed to be reserved until the appropriate time. Keeping her desire under control was right, but it did not prevent her from apprehensions about the wedding night. Therefore, they have restrained from acting on temptation to engage in physical intimacy prematurely. Verse 2, I will rise now and go about the city in the streets, and in the broad ways I will seek him whom my soul loveth. I sought him, but I found him not. The absence of her future husband in the bride's dream transforms it into a nightmare, causing intense feelings of insecurity to arise again. Was the relationship over? Had the man she loved abandoned her? Was the wedding off? What could she do to restore her relationship? In response to the groom's absence, she dreamed that she left her bridegroom and went into the city to search for her husband-to-be. The verb rendered will seek and sought occurs four times in the Song of Solomon, chapter 3, verse 12. This verb connotes an individual's intense search for something of someone. It also can mean to desire or long for. In this case, the bride fully intended to locate her groom and secure him for herself alone. The bride's dream-based search, I want you to pay attention, the bride's dream-based search, she didn't actually do it, she was dreaming about it, pointed to her deep love, which compelled her to acquire him for herself. God's design for marriage is an exclusive relationship between one man and one woman for a lifetime. Here the bride was willing to risk the dangers of a shadowy nighttime search to acquire such an exclusive relationship with her groom. Verse 3, the watchmen that go about the city found me, to whom I said, saw ye him whom my soul loveth. The watchmen that go about in the city that found me. Who are these watchmen? They are the ministers of the gospel. You see here that she asked the watchman the question, saw ye him whom my soul loveth, meaning Christ, who was still the object of her love and the uppermost in her thoughts, whom she thus describes without mentioning his name, as if he was the only him in the world worthy of any regard, which shows how much he was in her mind, how much the desires and affections of her soul were towards him, and that these ministers need no other description of him. So whenever you find him, you will know who is him. Verse 4, it was but a little that passed from them, but I found him whom my soul loveth. I held him and would not let him go until I brought him into my mother's house and into the chambers of her that conceived me. The woman's daring search paid off. She found her love. Her response was instinctive, a genuine feature of romantic love. She passionately seized and clung to him. Open expressions of commitment between engaged and married couples is appropriate. It strengthens the couple's bond to each other and publicly proclaims their unavailability to other suitors. Within the context of the bride's dream, the embrace pointed to her need to be close to her groom and the intensity of her love for him. The phrase, "my mother's house," represents a place of security. It was there the bride grew up, where her mother taught her about life. Verse 5, "Promise me, women of Israel, swear by the swift deer and the gazelles that you will not interrupt our love." This verse repeats the charge given in chapter 2, verse 7. The repetition emphasizes the importance of the pronouncement. While the verse is addressed to the young women of Jerusalem, its counsel is applicable to both young women and young men. The unmarried cautions against pursuing physical intimacy before marriage. Gazelles, female deer, conjure up images of love and intimacy. They symbolize the full experience of love and sexuality that God intended in marriage. The bride warned other young unmarried women that becoming sexually active before marriage would deprive them of enjoying God's design fully. The most intimate physical expressions of love are the best and most meaningful in the context of a committed marriage. Having issued her warning, the bride's attention turned to the approach of her groom. In chapter 3, verse 6 through 8, the groom's arrival coincided with the arrival of spring. Spring is recognized universally as a season of love, yet their commitment to purity and faithfulness is defined by the Lord rather than by culture gave them the necessary safeguards to wait until their wedding night for physical intimacy. This section of love song ends with the bride's admonition not to stir up or awaken love until the appropriate time. The human drive for physical intimacy is strong. Part of what distinguishes human beings from all other created life, however, is the God-given capacity to keep our physical desires under control. As believers, this capacity has been restored to us by the presence of the Holy Spirit in us. The Holy Spirit enables us to listen to and obey the safeguards within His Word. God created physical intimacy to be enjoyed exclusively by a husband and a wife within their committed marriage relationship. The Bible contains numerous passages in the Old Testament and New Testament concerning the proper role of the physical desires and guidelines for achieving their ultimate potential. Following the biblical parameters builds strong relationships. For Christian couples, a healthy, Christ-honoring marital relationship is part and partial relationship with God. Both Old Testament prophets and New Testament apostles declare the marriage to be an analogy of God's relationship to His covenant people. May God bless the reading and hearing of His word. Next week we'll be looking at chapter 5. Keep the faith. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank You for Your word. Help us, Father, to understand. Help us to follow what You have given in Your word. Be with us this day, Father. I pray for the upcoming sermon that You will be with the pastor. Guide us, Father, in Your holy name we pray. Amen.